Good morning, I'm Mike Navalio.
And I'm Nikita Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, the Philippines classified as a high travel risk due to COVID-19 by the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
A third official of the Philippine Sugar Regulatory Agency resigns over the sugar importation controversy.
Local transport groups asked the Supreme Court for a temporary restraining order on the no-contact apprehension policy. We speak with Pasang Masda President Obit Martin later on the program.
And U.S. First Lady Jill Biden tests positive for COVID-19.
Thank you for joining us. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention again labels the Philippines as a high travel risk for COVID-19. The country was included with Nepal and Russia in the high-risk group, or level 3, of the CDC's latest travel and health notice. A category applies to countries with over 100 new COVID cases over the past 28 days. The agency is advising Americans to make sure they are up to date with their COVID vaccines before making any trip to the Philippines. The Philippine Health Department points out the risk classification metrics used by the country are different from those of the CDC.
Sa CDC, ang ginagamit po nila yung incidence rate triangulated with the testing data. Dito po sa ating bansa, we know na ito pong number of cases ay hindi po na natin binibigyan ng equal weight with our healthcare utilization.
The Philippines logged more than 2,000 new COVID infections on Tuesday, raising the number of active cases to 36,190. The DOH also detected over 1,000 more cases of the highly transmissible Omicron subvariants BA.5 and BA.4.
The Philippine Health Chief admits the country's reputation may be affected after millions of its COVID vaccine doses went unused and eventually expired. Health Department Officer in Charge, Maria Rosario Vergeres, says they are taking steps to prevent this from happening again. Vergeres says the Health Department will try to get replacement jabs from the COVAX facility, but she notes it may not be possible to replace the entire batch of expired vaccines.
Not really concrete repercussions, pero syempre yung credibility ng bansa as to absorptive capacity will be so much affected kapag tayo ay nakaka-violate ng ganitong mga kondisyon ng isang donee o yung nagbibigay, anong donor natin. Ano? So atin pong nakikipag-usap sa COVAX, that's why our negotiations with them, our recommendations, they will replace not the entire number of vaccines na sinabi natin kahapon kung ilan yung nag-expire. Ngunit meron lang tayong specific amount of vaccines na hinihingi to be replaced. So that alam natin ito yung requirements natin for the succeeding months.
The Health Department preparing for a possible non-extension of the COVID-induced state of emergency. Preparations include coordinating with Congress for the amendment of a law to ensure the continued use of COVID vaccines.
When we discussed with the President, binigyan natin siya ng options. Kung talagang hindi malift ang state of calamity, we are recommending that the RA-11525, which is the National Vaccination Law for COVID-19, be amended para maipasok natin dito sa batas na ito na gagawin o the amended law itong mga considerations natin. For example, yung ating EUA na kailangan magpatuloy pa rin sa mga bakuna kasi hanggang sa ngayon, iisa pa lang manufacturer ang nagsubmit. Katulad ng COVID-19 vaccine deployment program natin, nakalink din yan sa state of calamity. Pati na rin yung ating tax exemptions para sa ating commodities for COVID-19, price caps, healthcare workers benefits, at saka yung mga protocols na pinapatupad natin ngayon for our state of calamity or for COVID-19. So worst case scenario natin, if ever, hindi po natin mapa-extend ang state of calamity, may pinaghahandaan na po ang kagawaran ng kalusugan at nakikipag-usap tayo sa legislative department ng ating our branch of government para matulungan tayo for us to amend RA-11525.
As for Joey Concepcion, member of the Private Sector Advisory Council, he says he would support the government should it decide to no longer extend the state of emergency. But he points out government needs to ensure the readiness of vaccine manufacturers to apply for a certificate of product registration.
Isang importante dyan is that yung mga vaccine manufacturers na are bringing the vaccines here, are they going to file for a certificate of product registration? No, importante yan for us, for the public to be able to buy the vaccines, or will the government continue to buy the vaccines? So if the government will continue to buy the vaccines, then they may have to issue an emergency use EUA, no? Yeah. So it depends, no? Whatever it is, I think the government can always, we can still remove the public state of health emergency. Ang tingin ko, I would support that. Because even countries na tumataas sa mga kaso, wala naman public state of health emergency.
The state of emergency is set to expire on September 13.
State auditors flagged the Philippine Health Department for supposed lapses in its COVID pandemic response. They cited its low fund utilization, its failure to prevent COVID vaccine doses from going to waste. The details from Adrian Ayali.
Despite the aggressive push of the Department of Health on its COVID-19 vaccination drive, the agency failed to impress the Commission on Audit, which cited lapses in its inoculation efforts, among other programs to counter the spread of the coronavirus. In the 2021 audit report on the DOH, state auditors noted wasted vaccines totaling 32,724 doses and almost expired ones totaling 12,854 vials. According to the audit team, the delays in the administration of vaccines may ultimately lead to wastage of government resources. The DOH explained to the auditors, however, that wastages of vaccines comprised of newer jabs with shorter shelf life of 6 months pursuant to the emergency use authorization of the Food and Drug Administration. The audit report also stated that for 2021, there were unobligated COVID-19 funds amounting to 6.648 billion pesos. And undisbursed funds totaling 23.656 billion pesos. Auditors said the low utilization of government funds can be counter-beneficial to the efforts of the department in controlling the spread of COVID-19. The DOH management, however, told the audit team that among the causes of low utilization of funds were cancellation and failure of procurement, delays in liquidation reports of previous fund transfers, among others. While the procurement service of the Department of Budget and Management procured COVID-19-related items using funds transferred by the DOH, the auditors noted non-receipt of items amounting to 18.557 million pesos by recipients indicated in property transfer reports, as well as delivery of items amounting to 166.21 million pesos to agencies other than the intended recipients. The DOH management said in its response to the audit team that it has requested an explanation from the Office of Civil Defense, as most of the deficiencies were observed during deliveries of the items. The audit team also noticed improper charging by Culion Sanitarium and General Hospital of Medicines, such as Remdesivir and Tocilizumab, as well as personal protective equipment of health workers to patients at marked-up prices. Among the reasons cited by the hospital was that the medicines were procured during an emergency situation, but prices were subsequently readjusted. The DOH told the audit team that government hospitals were given priority in the allocation. DOH Officer in Charge Maria Rosario Vergere stressed that the department has 60 days to respond to the audit report, but she also has this request to the commission.
We hope also and we request that other government agencies will try to avoid announcing to the public until po nakakapag-usap with the concerned government agency, so as not to give this kind of perception to people na meron na agad na issue kung eh hindi pa naman ho nakakapagpaliwanag ang DOH. Let us try to review this first, evaluate, and then after nung binibigay niyong 60 days sa amin, saka po tayo magpapaliwanag sa atin pong mga kababayan.
Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
All 10 close contacts of the Philippines' lone monkeypox case did not exhibit any symptoms throughout their isolation. The quarantine period ended Tuesday, but health officials say physicians will still check on them today before they can be discharged. The country's first monkeypox case was announced last July 29th. The patient finished isolation on August 5th.
The new procurement service chief of the Philippine Budget Department suspends the purchases of non-common use supplies and equipment for the government. PSDBM Executive Director Denis Santiago says the suspension will allow them to focus on fulfilling their primary mandate, which is to procure essential common use items such as office supplies. A member of the Senate minority, Risa Ontiveros, is pushing for a Senate probe of all procurements carried out by the PSDBM. That's after the office was linked to a fresh controversy involving overpriced and outdated laptops that government purchased for teachers.
In other news, transport groups challenged the no-contact apprehension policy before the Supreme Court. The groups led by Pasang Masda are asking the High Court for a temporary restraining order on the policy's implementation. Supreme Court spokesperson Brian Osaka says the petition was filed on August 3rd. Named as respondents were several local governments in Metro Manila and the Land Transportation Office. The High Court has given them 10 days to comment on the TRO petition. But the mayors of Quezon City and Valenzuela City say they will continue to implement the measure. They claim it has helped improve traffic discipline in their cities. For more on their petition, we now speak with Pasang Masda President Obet Martin. Magandang umaga ka, Obet. Salamat sa pagpapunlak sa mga interview.
Magandang umaga, Tony Mike, at sa mga naikinig po sa atin nanonood. Magandang umaga, Kiniki.
Alright, ka Obet, ano po yung objection ninyo doon sa no-contact apprehension policy ng LTO at ng ilang LGU sa Metro Manila? At bakit niyo po naisipang questionin ito sa Korte Suprema?
Alam mo, Tony Mike, itong non-contact apprehension nito, totally hindi kami against. Ang pinaglalaban lamang namin dito, yung exorbitant fees, penalties, na ipinapataw sa aming mga operator. Ang isang tanong lang namin dito, Attorney, ang mga driver natin, traffic violation, sila ang nagkukumi. Dapat driver dyan ang magbayad ng penalty. Pero bakit kami operator ang pinapadalan ng mga notice na nagkukumi ang aming driver at kami ang pinagmumulta? Para bang attorney, para bang kasalanan Pedro Ye, siwa na magbabayad. Pwede ko ba sa batas yan? At wala akong konsultasyon sa aming public transport ng kanilang inilatag itong non-contact apprehension. Ang ibig lang namin sabihin, sana kinonsulta kami para nakapag-input din po kami ng aming mga dapat sabihin. At dito, napakabigat ng penalty. 2,000 sa City of Manila. I'm from Manila, attorney. Under Republic Act 4136, Republic Act 79 offer ng MMDA, loading and unloading in a prohibited zone, ₱300 or ₱500. Sa mga non-contact local government natin, 2,000 po ang pinakamababa. Attorney Mike, pandemya po po ngayon. At ang tinatanong namin dito, bakit napakataas ng penalty? Pwede bang, as a lawyer, pwede bang i-supersede ng city ordinance ang isang national law? Bakit mas mataas pa sila ng penalty dito sa national law? Yan po yung aming mga katanungan dito. Kaya hindi namin malaman, Attorney Mike, kung saan kami pupunta. Ito po, I will cite a very good example. Meron tayong bike lane. Kami ho pang nagbaba at tumapa sa bike lane violation. Paano kung ang pasayros namin ay mga senior, mga PWD, ang layo ng lalakarin? At wala pa ho kami designated GPSAT in the City of Manila. Or any LGUs, wala akong alam na designated GPSAT para aming babaan sa kaya ng pasero. Kanya po, huli kami lahat sa pagkakataon nito. Ang sinasabi ko lang po dito, Tor, hindi ho nakuha sa palakihan ng penalty ang pagdidisiplina sa driver. Pwede ho nating mababa ang penalty pag nagkaroon ng pangalawang pagkakamali ang chofer, ipatawag ng LGU, bigyan ng edukasyon, i-seminar po yan. Sapagkat maraming driver po ngayon, bato-bato sa langit, kung magaganta ang aking mga sama driver, hindi po nalalaman itong mga violation kanila inilalatan ngayon sa amin. Napakabigat po ng sitwasyon namin. Yun nga po, binabanggit ko, bakit kami? ANA traffic violation. Administrative violation sa amin po mga operator yan. pero kami ang pinagmumulta at kung hindi kami magbayad, ano na ho kagad, ipapa-alarm kami sa LTO para hindi kami mag-register ng aming sakyan. Kaya po ito yung winowork out to kay ASEC Guadis ng LTO. Bakit ganyan? Gagamitin ng LTO sa pansarili nilang pagkakakitaan. Parang income generating po ito, Tommy. Nabanggit ko ito. Sapagkat napakabigat.
Kaobet, bago ho natin punta, no? Bago natin isa-isahin yung mga objections ninyo, ano po ba ang naging epekto na? Kasi nabanggit ninyo, pinagmumulta kayo bilang operator. Pwede ba natin i-quantify gaano kalaki na ho ba yung multa na binayaran ninyo? Gaano kadami na ho bang, kumbaga, citations ang natanggap ninyo simula nang ipatupad itong no contact apprehension policy?
Actually, meron po ako isang membro dito sa Bayan, Bloomington, Espanya to Bloomington, Abinida. Isang operator lang po ito, Attorney Mike. Hindi namin mairehistro ang sakyan dahil naka-alarma. Alam po ang binayaran namin kung magkano, 23,000 pesos.
Para sa isang taon lang ho ba ito, Kaobet?
Para sa isang unit lang ho yan.
Isang unit?
Opo, hindi ho isang taon yan. Sa loob lamang na ilang buwan yan. Mm-hmm. At meron po mga driver dito na talagang kailangan natin sila ma-educate, mabigyan ng seminar, para malaman nila itong mga inilatag nito ng local government, eh masunod nila. Mm-hmm. Hindi ho nangyayari yan. Antimano, ikaw ay bibigyan ng notice ng operator, at kung hindi mga bayaran, ulitin ko, hindi ka pa mag-re-register ng sakyan. Attorney Mike, ang mga driver po, they come and go. Kung paano, kung galit ang isang driver sa operator, hindi puro violation po ang iiwanan niya at ang magdudusa ang operator. Yan lang po isang pinakamabigat na yung pinaglalaban na hindi namin kaya tanggapin na kasalanan ni Pedro, siwa na ang nagdudusa.
Oh, Kaobet, pero on the other hand, no, pwede rin sabihin kasi ng mga nagsusulong nito na hindi ba obligasyon ng operator na mamili ng maayos na driver para masigurong hindi sila lalabag sa traffic violations at maiwasan itong mga penalties?
Tama po yan. Pero alam po rin yung ang driver, pag nasa labas na, iba na nagiging attitude. Ang behavior niya, attorney, kung saan maraming paseros, kahit mag-violate, kukunin yan dahil gustong tumita. Kung na pandemya, mahina ang kita, mataas pa ang presyo ng petroleum product ng diesel namin ngayon. At yun niya ho, kung magagalit ang ating mga super, eh paano kung galit sa operator? Kung minsan, no, hindi nagkakasundo niya. Yun po ang sinasabi ko. Dapat, bakit hindi sila gumawa ng mga pamamaraan, ang mapinahan ay ang mga driver na siyang gumagawa ng batas trafiko, na siyang nagkukumit ng batas trafiko. Mm-hmm. Ba't kaming operator? Nasa bahay lang kami. Naglalakad kami. Ba't kami ang magmumulta? Hindi po siguro maganda yung intention na yun ng local government. Kaya sinasabi ko nga po, kung ang mga driver ay nahuli, bigyan ng edukasyon. Bigyan ng paliwanag ng kanilang opisina, magtatag sila ng isang education room para ang mga driver na nahuli na managkamali sa batas trapiko, especially in the city of Manila, bigyan edukasyon nila na ito yung mali. Wala pong ganun nangyayari.
Kaobet, sa petisyon ninyo no, na humihiling na isang temporary restraining order, ang sinasabi nyo may posibilidad na mawawalan kayo ng hanap buhay. Gano'ng kalaki ho yung posibilidad na ito? Pakita ho natin no, sa paanong paraan yung no contact apprehension policy ng LTO at ng ilang LGUs ay magdudulot ng kawalan ng hanap buhay sa ilang mga tsuper.
Attorney, halimbawa, meron isang particular route. I will say a very good example. Isang route na namin sa Manila, Tayuman. Kung ang lahat po ng driver na yun ay puro nakuli na, ano po ang gagawin ng operator? Ihinto na ako sa pagbibiyahe yan. Sapagkat, napakabigat nga ng penalty. Kung lahat ng driver na yan, lahat ang nahuhuli na yan, isipin niyo operator na magdudusa, magbabayad. Eh baka sabi ko nga, baka dumating na ang panahon, hindi na kayong mag-servisyo. Sapagkat lahat ng kikitain namin, mapunta na lamang sa kanila. Eh palagay ko hindi naman ho tama yun.
So Kaobet, ang objection niyo ba Kaobet ay dahil operator yung pinapatawan ng penalty o ng multa at hindi yung driver mismo? Kasi pwedeng argument din Kaobet, bakit hindi singilin ng operator sa driver yung multang babayaran nito?
Well, alam mo po ninyo, Tony, wala hong, ang mga driver po yung napakahirap sa hindi. Pagdating sa offer, kumita lang po yung gap ng 200. Kumita lang po ako ng 150. Eh, paano hong gagawin natin dyan? Kanya hong napakabigat yan. Hindi lamang po yung operator kami at ang pinaglalaban namin, yung pinaglalaban, kundi po yung exorbitant fees na ipinapataw ng local government sa driver at sa operator. Sobra-sobra po. Ito, napakabigat.
So, for the record lang, Kaobet, yung pag-implement ng no-contact apprehension policy na gumagamit ng digital camera, gumagamit ng CCTV, wala ho kayong objection doon? Kasi sa petition ninyo, ang sinasabi niyo doon na isa, hindi daw nabibigyan ng pagkakataon na kaagad na i-question or questionin yung citation. Kasi sa no-contact apprehension policy, papadalan ka ng citation, hindi doon sa mismong spot kung saan ka supposedly lumabag doon sa traffic rules. So ano po ba talaga yung in-objection na nino? Itong policy mismo o yung exorbitant fees lamang?
Pareho yung polisiya nila at exorbitant fees. Kasi nga po ganito. Pag hinuli ang driver na, padadalan kami ng notice. Aabutin mga isa-dalawang buwan. Mm-hmm. Kung minsan attorney, wala na ang driver sa atin.
Mm-hmm.
O paano gagawin namin yan? So we will suffer the consequence. Kaya nga po ang sinasabi namin, maaari ba kayong humanap sa ibang pamamaraan na hindi kami operator ang mapepena kundi ang mga driver? Alam nyo, mas maganda yung suggestion ng Quezon City DPOS ni General San Diego. Alam mo, attorney, ang kanyang suggestion, for the day, limbawa, August 15, lumabas ako si Juan de la Cruz, nagmamaneho ng plate number na doon may rutang na Quezon City to Panay Street. Nagkaroon ng violation na ininotice kaming mga operator. Dadal namin sa kanila yan. Tapos, padadal na sa L2R para driver ang bigyan ng notice for that particular violation. Ito ay natutuwa kami doon. Subalit, we are still questioning yung exorbitant fees. Masyadong mataas, hindi po makakaya ng driver. Bigyan natin ang, sabi ko nga po, hindi sa palakihan ng penalty para madisiplina ang driver. Yan ay kahit malitang penalty niya. Naalala ko po si former chairman Bayan Fernando, kahit 300 lang ang penalty niya, kung tatlong beses nag-commit ng traffic, nahuli natin, i-hold ang lisensya, ipatawag, bigyan ng edukasyon. I-educate natin ang driver, i-seminar natin, o bigyan natin siya ng social services para malaman nila yung hirap na ginagawa nila. Yung kanilang traffic violations ginawa ay merong penalty. Ito ang gagawin mo. Education po, Attorney Mike, education. Kulang pa ng edukasyon ng ating mga driver.
Ang sinasabi ko ng mga mayors ka, Obet, no, itong no-contact apprehension policy, tumutulong para mag-create ng disiplina sa mga nagmamaneho. Hindi lamang sa mga nagda-drive para sa mga operators, pero sa lahat, no, pangkalahatan, lahat ng motorista. Dahil kapag alam nila na may digital camera o may CCTV na pwede silang mahuli, na hindi, kumbaga, fina-flag, no, eh, magdadalawang isip na nilumabag sa traffic rules. Kasi ang sinasabi ng iba, kapag walang nakakita, walang violation. But with this policy, makikita na ngayon kung sino talaga yung lumabag. Hindi ba ito magka-create ng disiplina? Hindi ba nito maiiwasan yung pangungutong? Kasi di ba, kapag fina-flag ka, may opportunity para sa pangungutong.
Nabanggit mo, Attorney Mike, ang photo. Marami akong driver kung merong nakausap. Eh, mabuti pa nga ang traffic enforcer eh. Sandana, na-ready nila yun. Itong CCTV nito, 2,000 in the city of Manila. So, pero po ang photong niyan.
Na-arreglo.
Ang photong niyan. Naareglo ang traffic enforcer.
Kaobet, naareglo. Pero that's outside the legal means. Yes. Sinasabi mong areglo.
Opo, areglo. Sandaan. Tatlong beses mahuli ang driver, 300 pesos. Dito, tatlong beses kang mahuli ang city of Manila, 9,000 pesos. Kanya po, maraming dapat pag-usapan pa. Kanya yung binabanggit yung disiplina. Tama po yan. Kanya, pinapasok naman dito. Mag-put up ang mga local government na isang room for education ng mga driver. Patawag ang mga nag-violate, bigyan ng edukasyon, eto sa ganitong lugar, eto meron tayong non-contact apprehension, kailangan mag-disiplina kayo at kailangan sumunod kayo sa batas trafiko para hindi kayo mag-penalty ang operator. Wala pong ganon, Attorney Mike. Yung po hinaasam-asam po. At kung magkakaganon po, halimbawa, kung ang mga driver namin sa rutang Bloomington Balot to Bloomington Texon, nasabihan, na-educate lahat ng driver, and aside from that, nag-commit pa ng violation, attorney, wala na akong magagawa sa kanila. Talagang dapat silang parusahan, dapat silang magdusa. Pero, huwag masyadong sobra-sobra ang penalty. Hindi po kumikita ng ganyang kalaki ang driver sa ngayon.
Kaobet, ang sabi nilang mayor, itutuloy nila yung kanilang pagpapatupad ng no-contact apprehension policy hanggat wala pa namang nilalabas na TRO yung Korte Suprema on your petition, ano? Ano pong panawagan ninyo sa mga local government units at maging sa LTO?
Ako naman po eh, nakipag-ugnayan na kami sa LTO kahapon. So happened that as Assistant Secretary Rodriguez was sent around, nakaus kami sa Torno Bona at ang ibang legal team, sa mga abogado, napag-usapan namin niya. At sabi ko nga, para ma-enhance to, magpatawag ang LTO sa local government, pag-usapan natin ang mga problema. At nang noon po maayos natin to, hindi po pwedeng ayaw ng local government, gusto ng LTO ipagpapat. Siguro ipatawag nila ang mga local government, mag-usap sila. At pag-usapan maayos sa Torno Mike, ano ba to? At kami imbitahan during the said meeting para makapag-input naman po kami ng aming mga nagiging problema. At siyempre kami dapat isama dyan dahil kami ang concern. At makapagbibigay po kami siguro ng mga magagandang sasabihin sa ating local government na ganito-ganito. Eh hindi ho nangyayari nung nakaraan. Ngayon, ipagpapatuloy po nila yan. Wala ho kami magagawa at karapatan nila yan. At karapatan din po naman namin na i-contesta lahat ang puno nila at iparting sa kinauukulan ang mga ginagawa ng Pangulo.
Alright, maraming salamat po sa panayam ngayong umaga, Kaobit Martin ng Pasang Masta.
Maraming salamat, Attorney Mike, sa ENC. Isang magandang umaga po. At kay Ma'am Nikit, sa naiting natanunod, magandang umaga po at pagpalayan tayo ng pagkakas.
Meanwhile, over 500 traffic enforcers to be deployed in the National Capital Region when schools reopen next week. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority is expecting some 436,000 vehicles along EDSA Highway on the first day of classes on August 22nd. The agency says enforcers will seek to ensure traffic will be manageable and that travel for students will be safe when they return to classes.
Siguraduhin po, ligtas yung mga mag-aaral natin. At ito po ang mag-clear ng ating mga pedestrian lanes, yung mga yellow boxes. At pananatilihin po ang kaayusan, lalong-lalo na po sa bangketa at yung mga kalsada na nakapaligid dyan. At siguraduhin po walang naka-obstruct para tuloy-tuloy po at daloy ng trapiko para sa mga magulang na mag-aatid at magsusundo po ng kanilang mga anak.
Philippine poll watchdogs voicing their concern over a move in Congress to postpone the country's December elections for village and youth council officials. The Parish Pastoral Council for Responsible Voting, or PPCRV, says a postponement would deprive citizens of their right and critical need to replace leaders who did not adequately exercise their mandate. Lente and Namfrel also oppose the move, saying the village and youth council polls have already been postponed.
We believe that the said election has long been overdue, being postponed for 3 times already.
Primarily because we see that elections have to be conducted periodically and regularly to uphold the right of every citizen to assess and judge the leaders that they elect.
We are also preparing to a more important elections in 2025 and 2028. Many of your colleagues here in the House of Representatives have been wanting to prepare early for the 2025.
Voting 12-2, the House Committee on Suffrage decided to move the Village and Youth Council elections to December 2023. The bill will now have to be submitted to the plenary.
The national and local elections have just been concluded this 2022. To conduct barangay and sanggunian kabataan elections this year would definitely add to the present division of the electorate.
Roughly 2 years were lost for our elected officers to carry out their regular mandate. It is only fair that we make up for this year's continuity in the implementation of our barangay-level programs and projects stand as the best interest for our communities.
COMELEC says they will continue to prepare for the village and youth council elections set on December 5 until a final decision is made. The Senate will have its own hearing on the matter next week. But Senator Jingoy Estrada says they want to hold the elections on May 2023.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, a third official of the Philippine Sugar Regulatory Agency resigns over the sugar importation controversy.
and top soda producers in the Philippines facing a shortage of premium refined sugar. These and more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web. Ecuador's banner story online. Senator Rafi Tulfo grills the bureaus of Internal Revenue and Customs over their priorities. Philippine Star's top story, the COMELEC chairman says they will need an additional 5 billion pesos if the village and youth council polls are delayed. And topping JMA News' website, the Population Commission says the government should enact measures in response to the Philippines' aging population.
The chief of the Sugar Regulatory Administration is the latest to quit following the sugar importation controversy. Hermenegildo Serafica says he's leaving the office with a light heart and clear conscience, having performed his duty within the bounds of law. Several groups welcome Serafica's resignation, but they still want the investigation to continue.
Pinakinggan niya yung panawagan ng karamihan mamamayan na mag-resign muna sa SRA bilang SRA chief para mabigyan ng walang dudang pag-imbestiga no sa nangyayari ngayong anomalya sa loob mismo ng Department of Agriculture.
Only one out of the four signatories of the controversial sugar order has yet to resign. Crop Planters representative and acting board member Aurelio Valderrama, there's no reason for him to quit his post.
I have not resigned and I have not received any instructions from the president. But I wrote the president a letter and I told the president I am at his disposal. If he finds that there is something wrong, then he tells me to resign. It's as simple as that.
And the House...
The House panel investigating the controversial sugar importation order wants to know if officials were pressured into signing the resolution without the president's consent. During Monday's hearing, former Agriculture Undersecretary Leocadio Sebastian said he signed the resolution due to the country's dwindling sugar stockpile. But Congresswoman Florida Robes, the chairperson of the House Committee on Public Accountability, says that's not an excuse to bypass President Marcos.
It's still not an excuse. Hindi po yun ay magbibigay daan para gawin niya ito dahil nakakapag-usap naman siya sa ating Pangulo. Kahit saang departamento, dapat kung ikaw ay merong boss, dapat nakikipag-usap ka at tinatanong mo ito ng matuwid bilang isang subordinate.
The sugar importation fiasco comes as top beverage companies in the country confirm they are facing a shortage of premium refined sugar. More from Jackie Pascual.
The sugar supply problem has started to take its toll on the business community. The Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry says the country is experiencing a shortage, and many large manufacturers and small businesses are getting more worried. PCCI President George Barcelon asserts there is a need to import sugar now.
We're already seeing prices increases. Mga beverages, nag-slow down yung production. Smaller ones, I heard, no, they're stopping their operation in the meantime kasi hindi nila maasahan yung supply ng sugar eh.
Top beverage companies in the country have issued a joint statement confirming the industry is facing a shortage of refined sugar, which is a key ingredient of their products. They say they are working with stakeholders and government to address the situation. Some small businesses have already raised prices, particularly those that require sugar, such as bake shops and milk tea shops.
Price increase talaga. Medyo affected po lahat ng mga home bakers. Yung eggs and yung sugar, kasi yun po yung common sa mga baking industries. So, ayun po, medyo heartbreaking siya.
Hindi man namin gusto magtaas, kailangan talaga namin magtaas.
Some stores are still trying to cope with the problem by not implementing price hikes just yet. But that too may change.
Mas maganda po siguro na kami magtiis kaysa yung mga customer po namin yung mahirapan. Pag bumili po sila isang beses, tapos maramdaman nila, ayun, taas pala dito. Hindi na sila bibilik.
The Restaurant Owners Association of the Philippines hopes the problem will be resolved soon, highlighting the fact that most stores are using sugar in many products. The group hopes government will help the sugar farmers to have better supply in the long run. Go Negocio founder Joey Concepcion, whose family once owned a beverage company, agrees that local farmers must first be protected. He wants government to plan the importation ahead of time so it will not have a negative effect on the local sugar sector.
Alam naman natin na yung panahon ng pagka-harvest, so we already should plan, no? Whether importation should be allowed, pero much earlier, no? Harvest is starting to happen.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has earlier said he may import 150,000 metric tons of sugar in October. He has also met with members of the Chamber of Food Manufacturers, Inc., which counts as members, big corporations using sugar in their products. Marcos eyes direct importation of sugar through industry players to address supply problems. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Jaime Augusto Zubeldi Ayala will serve as the acting chairman of Ayala Land. His brother and chairman, Fernando Zubeldi Ayala, takes a medical leave. Jaime Augusto earlier said the family fully supports his brother's decision to focus on his health. No other details about his condition were disclosed. The Ayala Corporation CEO and president went on a medical leave earlier this week. He also stepped down as the chairman and member of the executive committee, but he remains a member of the board of directors.
Officials of the Philippine Internal Revenue Bureau grilled by senators over its failure to reach its tax collection targets from Philippine offshore gaming operators of POGOs. The Bureau had been expected to collect over 30 billion pesos in annual taxes from POGOs since 2019. But data show the agency missed its target by a wide margin. BIR Commissioner Lilia Guillermo blamed the low tax collection numbers on the gambling crackdown in China and a Philippine Supreme Court ruling, which bars the agency from collecting the 5% franchise tax on POGOs. Despite this explanation, Senate Ways and Means Committee Chairman Sherwin Gatchalian called for a separate hearing to look into the issue.
And a look now at the financial markets. The Dow rose for a fifth straight day Tuesday. Its earnings results from Walmart and Home Depot showed consumer spending in the U.S. remains strong. It added 239 points, while the S&P 500 also booked modest gains. But the Nasdaq slipped, dragged by tech shares. Over at the White House, U.S. President Joe Biden signed into law the $430 billion measure dubbed Inflation Reduction Act, which is also the biggest climate package in Washington's history. Over in Europe, markets managed to close higher after struggling to build that momentum during Tuesday's session. And here in Asia, stocks ended mixed as strong rallies from Chinese real estate companies and Australian miners were offset by muted Japanese and Hong Kong markets. Philippine shares advanced for seventh straight day, jumping 1.6% and back to the 6,800 level.
After 10 months in space, the Filipino-made Maya 3 and Maya 4 cube satellites have completed their missions. What data were they able to gather during their deployment into the orbit? To answer our questions, we have with us today one of the developers of the Maya satellites, Engineer Judiel Reyes. Good morning, Engineer Judiel. Thank you for joining us.
Good
Good morning po everyone. Thank you for having me here.
All right. First off, congratulations on a successful mission. Tell us what data the Maya satellites were able to gather while up in space.
Thank you, po. So before I proceed with the satellite's performance in space, so let me first give you a brief introduction about this project. So The main objective of the project is to teach us the satellite development process, or in simple terms, how to build a satellite. And the best way to learn this process is to actually build one. So the project is investing in human resources and capacity building. And this is where the Cube satellite comes in. So the one unit of Cube satellite is an economically practical project to use in learning the satellite development process. So because it contains all the basic systems or the building blocks of the satellite. So doing this project will require the developers to go through the actual phases and different reviews, the same as the big ones or the big satellites uses.
Right.
So with the smallest size of the satellite, but with the advancement of technology in smaller components, we were still able to fit several payloads in the Cube satellite. So this can have notable capabilities, but still far from the sophistication and capabilities of the bigger satellite.
And what of the data gathered?
So for the Cube satellite's performance, so both Maya 3 and 4 have onboard communication payloads, so capable of APRS and digipeating function. So with this, we were able to broadcast beacons containing information about its payload, including its call sign. So this function, in other terms, is like a message repeater. So we were able to serve amateur radios, operators, or ham operators in several parts of the world, so some of which either received the beacon or performed the digipeating function. So from Asia, we have Philippines, Japan, Thailand. We get also feedback from Europe, France, Netherlands, Germany, Italy, and Greece, and from America, North, Central, and South America, from USA, Panama, and Argentina. So we also gather data from its instruments aboard the satellite about the health status, battery level, temperature, other parameters. We also have some experimental payloads like GPS module and the measurement of Earth's magnetic field. So these readings will undergo analysis and interpretations later on.
And the data gathered as well as the performance of the Maya 3 and Maya 4 satellites will be useful to which sectors of the country? Have you passed this info onto the concerned agencies?
For as of now, we have not yet have a intended or particular agency to that the gathered data will be useful for them, but the information gathered will give us a first-hand insight about the space environment that the satellite is experiencing, and we might later on extract important information that we may contribute to the space science and technology development in our country.
Right, and concerning the timeline of the project, are we right on track in terms of missions accomplished?
Yes, regarding the timeline, usually with the initial prediction, the lifespan of a satellite is around at the minimum of 6 months. So with the 10 months, so we exceeded that initial prediction. And for the past satellites, we also have more than a year, like for Maya 1. So, and for the missions, yes, we can say that we have a success for missions, especially for the communications payload of the Maya satellite.
So given that lifespan, what's next for the satellite development program then?
Now for the STEP project, so there is a next batch of Maya satellite developers, Maya 5 and Maya 6. So currently, the developers of the Maya 5 and 6 are in Japan, so to perform the space environment test and the acceptance test for the flight model of their satellite. So they are in our partner institution, the Kyushu Institute of Technology. So these tests are critical because this will be the basis of the launch provider and the coordinating agency like JAXA if they will accept and approve the satellite to be launched and deployed in space.
And Judiel, are you also eyeing future partnerships and space programs with other space agencies, maybe even outside the country?
For now, maybe that is for the PhilSA or the Philippines Agency to say, but I don't have more details on that matter.
All right. But given our improvements in the field of space science and technology, where do you see Filipino space projects in the future? What areas need most improvement still? Is funding still an issue?
For now, I can say that for PhilSA, so we're not technically related or directly part of PhilSA, and we cannot speak on behalf of them, but surely they have plans and current activities related to that, especially for development of more satellites. For example, is MULA satellite, or the multi-spectral unit for land assessment. So this is a commercial grade satellite weighing about 130 kilograms. So this will be the biggest one to date. So this can be used for environmental applications such as disaster management, land use, land cover change, crop monitoring, and forestry management. So more details about that MULA satellite can be found on the PhilSA website, philsa.gov.ph.
All right. Exciting things ahead. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Engineer Miguel. You stay safe. More power.
Thank you.
Meanwhile, the Philippine Commission on the Filipino Language, or Komisyon sa Wikang Filipino, is now reviewing an earlier memorandum that ordered the pullout and termination of publication of 5 allegedly subversive books. That's according to KWF Chair Arthur Casanova. The memo was signed by 2 KWF commissioners, Carmelita Abdurrahman and Benjamin Mendilio Jr. But Casanova says the order was released without his knowledge. He also believes the commission does not have the authority to ban and censor written works. He adds the books tagged as subversive went through the standard review process and were even approved by committees headed by Abdurrahman and Mendilio. Some of the books ordered for pullout were about the martial law period under the administration of the president's father, late dictator Ferdinand Marcos.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. may visit Indonesia or Singapore soon for his first overseas trip as the country's leader. Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Manuel Romualdez says the Foreign Affairs Department is already arranging the details of the trip. The trip to Asia will precede Marcos's visit to the U.S. for the United Nations General Assembly in September. According to Romualdez, a meeting with U.S. President Joe Biden at the sidelines of the UNGA is possible.
Kaya pag-uusapan nga namin kung paano namin naayusin yung bilateral meeting. Pero gusto rin ng White House na imbitahin talaga siya sa Washington. Siguro maganda rin na magka in-person usapan silang dalawa ni President Marcos, ni President Biden. So we're going to look at that as an option for them at the sidelines of the United Nations. Maraming mga world leaders na they're very curious to get to talk to our president now.
U.S. First Lady Jill Biden tests positive for COVID-19. The White House says the First Lady, who is double vaccinated and twice boosted, has mild symptoms. She has been prescribed the antiviral pill Paxlovid and will isolate for at least 5 days. President Joe Biden recently recovered from 2 separate bouts of COVID. He first tested positive on July 21 and continued carrying out his duties while in isolation. After 4 days of negative tests, he again received a positive result on July 30 and entered isolation for a second time.
2 possible COVID-19 cases sparked chaos in Shanghai. Panicked shoppers rushed at the exits at the IKEA branch after city health authorities ordered the store to lock down over an abnormal test result. Videos posted on social media showed customers pushing the doors open to get out of the store. Similar scenes unfolded at the building where a worker was identified as a close contact of a COVID case. China's zero COVID strategy involves snap lockdowns and quarantines, which have sparked anger and anxiety in some cities. Shanghai's 25 million residents have grappled with harsh COVID rules since earlier this year, when it was sealed off for 2 months to contain an outbreak.
The World Health Organization seeks the public's help in finding a new name for monkeypox. In its best practices for infectious disease names, the WHO cautions against using geographic locations, people's names, animal species, and other specific references. Pressure is growing for a new name for the disease, in part because critics say it is misleading, since monkeys are not the original host. Experts also warn the name could be stigmatizing. There have been reports of primates already being attacked in Brazil over fears of the virus. On Saturday, the Global Health Agency announced it had renamed the Congo Basin and West African variants of monkeypox to Clade 1 and Clade 2.
Malaysia's highest court will hear former Prime Minister Najib Razak's final bid to overturn his 12-year jail sentence for corruption. The appeal, which begins today, is the last high-stakes court gambit left open to Najib after the federal court rejected the former leader's plea for a retrial. An acquittal potentially clears the way for his return to power. But if unsuccessful, Najib will have to start serving his jail sentence after years of legal wrangling. Najib and his ruling party were tossed out of office in the 2018 elections following allegations of their involvement in a multi-billion dollar scandal at state fund 1MDB. Najib was found guilty of abuse of power, money laundering, and breach of trust over the transfer of millions from a former 1MDB unit to his bank account.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Penny Espinosa.
Good morning, guys. Here are the latest stories making headlines in the Filipino community. A Filipino-American family from Vallejo, California is asking the U.S. government for help after 40-year-old Grace Ortega Lujares fell into a coma while resting after days of hiking Machu Picchu and Peru with her friends. Grace is now on a ventilator at the ICU of Clinica Pardo Hospital.
Her friends called me and said, oh, Grace is being airlifted to the nearest hospital because she passed out. She might be suffering with pulmonary edema and possibly cerebral edema.
The Lujanes family is now seeking the help of the U.S. government to help bring Grace back home to the U.S. so she can get the medical attention she needs to survive.
We just wish we had more support from the U.S. Embassy. They haven't really been giving us updates on her status. And when I call and ask for help, they basically say that there's not much they can do in terms of helping facilitate to get her home. And she does have a lot of medical bills, and the hospital system there doesn't accept her insurance from here in the U.S.
A GoFundMe page has been created to help raise money so Grace can be brought back home to Vallejo, California.
Thank you, Lord.
Meanwhile, after several days due to the pandemic, the icon of the Santo Niño de Cebu has finally arrived in British Columbia, Canada. A week before the scheduled dedication of the new Santo Niño Shrine at the St. Anthony of Padua Church in Agassiz. The Santo Niño was donated to the Archdiocese of Vancouver by Nonito Lim Chua of Cebu before the pandemic.
Santo Niño is always, you know, almost in the heart of every Cebuano. And I had a wish that somehow it could be commemorated where I now live, you know, in Canada.
And finally, we head to San Francisco's Yerba Buena Gardens, where for the first time since the pandemic, the community has gathered in person for the Pistahan Parade and Festival over the weekend.
For the last 2 years, we survived two pandemics, pandemic of COVID and pandemic of Asian hate, you know. So this is more than ever. We need to come together in person, reconnect with our friends and our family.
Kapamilya stars joined the festivities by taking part in the parade along San Francisco's busiest streets. Headlining the main stage for the Sama Saya by I Want TFC and Mix are AC Bonifacio, Angela Kent, Sab, Laren Wong, and Kiana V.
Events like this, we don't have a lot of them in Manila, so I was so happy and actually a little emotional and overwhelmed by just how proud people are to be Filipino.
And those were the latest headlines from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to you guys for the rundown.
And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.